Greetings, salutations, and welcome to Sportslook, the sports television program for the high plains of West Texas and eastern New Mexico. I'm your host, Doc Elder, and just like the subject of a painting by Salvador Dali, time is slipping away from us this semester, but we've got enough time to put together a cool episode about volleyball. I'm going to have Jasmine Gannon from the volleyball squad in the present day as one of my guests. We're also going to do a throwback episode where Mike McGuire is going to be talking to a couple of volleyball players. So let's bring in Jasmine Gannon right now. Welcome back to Sportslook, and it is an honor to bring to the set of Sportslook one of the standouts of Greyhound volleyball, Jasmine Gannon. Jasmine, welcome to Sportslook.
Thank you for having me.
Jasmine, I assume that most everybody who is watching this program already knows the answer to these questions, but where are you from and what was the process that got you to Eastern?
Well, I went to high school at Texaco. I live in Clovis, though, and my mom played basketball here, and it was close to home, and Coach Poyer started talking to me probably my sophomore year of high school, so Eastern was always something that was on my radar.
Well, obviously, you were a standout athlete at Texaco High School and had some memorable experiences in volleyball, but also some memorable experiences in basketball.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I seem to remember winning a state championship.
Yes.
So between... is it like comparing apples and oranges when you talk about the state championships you won in high school?
Seems like it was just yesterday, to be honest with you, and can't believe it's been 4, 5, 6 years ago, but they were all a blast, and I would do them over 100 times if I could.
And it seems to me, because I broadcast your state championship volleyball, I also broadcast state championship basketball, and it seems like in some ways, you know, same experience, but it seems like they were a little bit different, because in the championship in basketball, there was a point where it looked like you could lose that game.
Oh, yes. I remember that game very vividly. We just did not have a good first half, and somehow we came back. Coach Luscombe got on us at halftime, and it was a really cool experience to come back from that.
Well, you're being far too modest. A big reason why was because in the second half, I've seen some players have really good second halves, but you took over the second half. Was it something that Coach Luscombe said, or was it just something internally? It's like, I have to step up here?
I don't know. I knew I was bigger than their posts, and I knew that I could be assertive down low, and once our guards started giving me the ball, we started playing more together, and I think we just ran from there.
And in terms of volleyball, like you said, your mom, a standout athlete, but a basketball player, was she a two-sport athlete that just became a college basketball player, or was volleyball something new to the Gannon family?
Volleyball was definitely something that was new. Mom was a track star, cross-country star. She won state cross-country. She won the 800, won the mile. She was a great runner along with basketball. So volleyball was definitely something that was new to our family.
So how did you get involved with volleyball?
Play every sport when you're younger, and you take to what you take to. So volleyball is definitely the one that I took to.
So who are the people that helped to make you the volleyball player you became?
So my dad, for sure. He played when he was in the Air Force, he would play pickup with the guys. And so when I started playing volleyball, I remember just constant hours of us just playing volleyball in the backyard over and over and over again. And Kristen Scanlon at Texaco, amazing coach, like one of the best women that I've ever met, ever played for. She's just phenomenal. And getting to play under her, I definitely have become the player that I have. And of course, Coach Poyer taking a chance on me out of high school, he's really developed my skills, and LV at Eastern as well, being the strength coach, becoming stronger and more conditioned has definitely helped me become a better player as well.
And Jasmine, to show you how long I've been at Eastern New Mexico University, Coach LV, who is Larry Bernardo, was actually a student of mine.
Oh.
Now you're looking at me like, wow, Doc, you are all you've been here for. Let's go back and talk a little bit about your high school days. In some ways, Coach Scanlon and Coach Luscombe, two completely different persons.
Very.
But in some ways, obviously, they have to be really good at their craft. So what is the persona of Coach Scanlon? What's the persona of Coach Luscombe?
I mean, both of them, I can say they never slacked off. They always gave us their 110%, and they expected us to give it right back to them. They didn't care who you were. They were going to play the best five or six players on the court that were going to get the job done, and they just had high expectations for everybody. Coach Scanlon was a little more calm at times while Coach Luscombe.
Really? Oh,
you know,
I find that hard to believe.
My freshman year, I was very scared of Coach Luscombe. You can ask him. Anytime that man yelled at me, yes, sir. Okay. But both phenomenal coaches and both just great character, great just everything.
And obviously, Texaco has had phenomenal success, which is good because there's certain fear factor the teams have when they play Texaco because they are Texaco. But yet, on the other hand, it's like everybody wants to knock Texaco off. So what was it like having the bullseye on you every time you went out on the court?
Oh, yes. The bullseye was, I feel like, always on our backs. And it, I mean, I think having Coach Scanlon and Coach Luscombe, they knew that. And so they always, that's why they made us work so hard, because they knew that everyone was working hard just to beat Texaco. So we always had that mindset that everyone's going to play their best game against us. They might have a terrible game and girls might score 20 points against us that might rarely see the floor in other games, but it just made us work harder, I think.
Jasmine, obviously Texaco is phenomenally good in sports, but no slouch academically.
Oh, no.
I mean, still, you know, year in and year out, one of the best schools in New Mexico regarding academics. And who were the teachers that you remember at Texaco?
Oh, I could go on and on and on, but Coach Ryan Autry, he's the AD now at Texaco, and I think he really developed my love for math. I'm a mathematics major, and he just, same thing. He had the same mindset as Coach Luscombe and Coach Scanlon to always push us to do the best, and he never let us slack off. And so he's a really memorable coach that I remember having as a coach in track and in the classroom.
And here again, to show you how old I am, Coach Autry, one of my students at Eastern New Mexico University. At what point did you start to think that maybe you could continue your athletic career on the college level?
I don't think I really started thinking about it until towards the end of my sophomore year. Coach Poyer had started to reach out to me, and I was like, whoa, I'm only a sophomore, you know? And so he started to reach out to me, and he would come to a few of my games, and I'd started playing pickup with the girls then, because granted, it was only 30 minutes away, so that was really helpful. And then my junior and senior year, I think I really developed as a player, and I grew a little bit, and I got a little stronger. And so then I was like, okay, this is something that I really think that I could do.
And obviously, for people that just think you show up, you maybe practice for a couple of hours, and that's all the involvement that college athletes have with athletics. It's way more demanding on the college level.
Yes, sir.
And obviously, there's a grade point component. You have to maintain a certain GPA, but there's conditioning, film to be watched. I mean, it's like a job.
Yes, sir. It's definitely like a job.
What was the biggest adjustment that you had to make academically and athletically going from the high school level to Eastern New Mexico?
Well, academically, I genuinely don't think I had to make that big of an adjustment because, like you said earlier, Texaco is just a phenomenal school when it comes to academics. So they already set those expectations high. So coming into college, I didn't really have a hard time transitioning. The math classes my junior year started getting really tough. So that was definitely a transition, but I think Texaco prepared me for that. Athletically, it was getting stronger, getting faster, knowing that it was your job. It wasn't just 2 hours in the afternoon like it was in high school. It was, you have this in the morning, you have this in the afternoon, you need to watch film, you need to do this, you need to prepare, you need to eat right. You know, it was so much more than just 2 hours in the afternoon, a game on Saturday. So I think it was a mental adjustment too, and coming into it knowing that you're not going to be the top dog. You have to work your way to the top. You might have been the best in high school, you could have been the best in the state, but you go into college and you're a freshman and you have girls that have been training over you for 4 years. And I think the game is faster, and so just adjusting to that, adjusting to harder hits, bigger blocks, just it's a faster game.
When you got to Eastern New Mexico University, was there a player or two that kind of took you under their wing and kind of showed you the ropes of what it was like?
Yes, sir. Andrea Aguilar, the libero from Clovis, and Brooklyn Bill, they were both seniors, and they definitely took me under their wing. Playing as a freshman was hard. It was very strenuous. I felt like I couldn't make any mistakes because I didn't want to let anybody down. But those two really reassured me because they both played at a very young age as well at the college level, and they were really, really good mentors to me.
Interestingly enough, Brooklyn Beal was a part of the Sportslook crew, and
yes,
she actually was one of the people that did High School Spotlight. So it's good to hear her name mentioned in this room once again. What similarities are there between Coach Scanlon and Coach Poyer, and in what ways are they different?
I think similarities would be that they both expect a lot from us. They both expect us to give our all every single practice, and if we're not willing to give our all, then that's a chance that they don't have to play us. You know what I mean? They expected us to be on time. They expected us to be prompt with everything. I think differences is Coach Poyer is a little more calm in his coaching. Coach Scanlon would pull us aside too, but she wouldn't be afraid to be like, Jasmine, why are you doing that? Yell at me across the court, whereas Coach Poyer would pull someone aside more so in a timeout and tell them, hey, this is what you need to do. This is the area you need to hit, stuff like that.
Was there a particular point during your freshman year when you realized I can play on this level, or was it just kind of a gradual step-by-step, match-by-match maturation?
I think about halfway through the season, I started playing really consistent, and I started having some decent numbers and decent hitting percentages. So I think at that point, I was like, okay, I'm supposed to be here. I'm supposed to be playing, and I'm doing a decent job at it.
Well, obviously, this year, of course, is an unusual year, but last year was an unusual year for you as well, because Coach Poyer had a health issue, had to step aside, and Katie Burnett, who had just literally become a coach at the assistant level, had to become a head coach. What was it like for you, the players, in that situation?
It was difficult, and I think it was really hard on Coach Katie as well, because she had just gotten thrown into that position, and she took it on amazingly. She did a wonderful job. She's an amazing coach. She knows her stuff. She knows her fundamentals, and she has high expectations of us as well. It was just difficult not having your coach there, you know, and you get so kind of complacent with the way that they coach and the way that they teach you, that sometimes when they're not there and you're thrown into someone with a completely different personality and a completely different coaching method, it's a little harder to adapt to. So I think that was definitely a struggle for us.
One thing that I was really proud of, and I got a chance to see you up close and personal instead of being up in the stands, because I was actually the public address announcer for a number of your home matches. And you may have lost to a team the first time around, but you beat a lot of teams the second time through the conference that had beaten you in the first half of the conference. What was the difference?
I think in the first half, we were just all jumbled. It was hard to get into a rhythm. It was hard to be like, oh, well, Coach Poyer this or Coach Poyer that. But then I think a few weeks in, when we knew okay, this is normal now. This is what we're doing. This is how we need to do things. We kind of started having a routine, and we started playing better together.
Well, and obviously we did talk about the fact that this year is a little bit unusual, to say the least, because
yes,
normally at this point we would be talking about Okay, you're finishing up the regular season, getting ready for hopefully a Lone Star Conference tournament. What was it like when you found out that volleyball wouldn't be taking place in the fall?
Oh, I was crushed. I was so heartbroken. This was supposed to be my senior year. And I was so ready. When we got put into quarantine and when COVID started becoming a big deal, I would work out 3 times a day. I would get extra reps. I would do as much as I could to be better, be a good senior, be a good captain, a good leader for the girls, the freshmen coming in. Like, that's heartbreaking to me that the freshman year of college, they can't come to the town that they committed to. Like, that's heartbreaking for me. And so it was heartbreaking to not know, but it was promising to be able to get that year back. And I've decided to stay here next year, get my master's in educational technology, and continue as a Greyhound for my fifth year, I guess.
Wow, well, breaking news here on Sportslook. That's why we do this program, so we can break the sports news. In the spring, if I understand it correctly, you will be doing your student teaching and playing volleyball. So how are you going to adjust those two demands?
Yes, sir. So Coach Poyer was very giving in putting our practices in the afternoon rather than in the morning. So it'll be after I student teach. And Malie Vinson is also student teaching in the spring as well. So I know for me, I won't be traveling because we're only playing 10 games, 5 home, 5 away against the same teams. So I possibly might go to the WT game, but the other ones are overnight and they're during the week, Tuesday, Wednesday, because of the whole scheduling. So I'm just gonna play the home games, possibly the away WT, save my body a little bit and just prepare for the fall.
Well, I had a momentary look of surprise because I was unaware. So the schedule is going to be adjusted. It's not going to be the usual like Thursday, Friday, or Thursday, Saturday.
From my understanding, I believe we're playing in the middle of the week. I don't know if I was supposed to say that. Sorry, Coach Poyer.
Wow. Well, we are really breaking news here on sports like that. So, Jasmine, if you had to say there's one thing you hope that people who come out and watch you play, if there's one thing that they'll walk away from the arena thinking about you as a player and a person, what do you hope their takeaway about Jasmine Gannon is?
I think I'd want my takeaway to be that she's a leader, that she wants what's best for her team, and that if what's best for her team is sitting on the bench and cheering her team on, then that's what she'll do. And so I think that's what I'd want people to take away from me.
Okay, and Jasmine, the most difficult question I saved for last year. Thinking back to all of the classes that you've taken at Eastern New Mexico University, what was your favorite class?
Oh, I think it would have to be your history class.
Oh, well, an unexpected answer. And I'm not just saying it because you're sitting across the table, but you were always the first student to check in. You always had very complete and thorough answers. So everybody at Texaco should be very, very proud you became a model student.
Oh, thank you.
Well, Jasmine, thanks for being our guest. Best of luck, and we're glad that we'll be able to see you for not just the spring, but next fall.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
All right. Well, that is going to wrap up the interview segment. So what we'll do is we'll clear the set and we'll queue up an episode featuring Mike McGuire talking to a couple of volleyball players right now.
Welcome to Sports Look. I'm your host, Mike McGuire, and as always, we've got a great show for you. Of course, we'll talk to Bud Elliott coming off a big victory over Texas A&M Commerce, and then we'll have Coach David Browder, and he's going to let us know how we wound up the rodeo fall season. But tonight's show, we're going to start off with two volleyball players, and there are also two E&MU Zia volleyball players and two former Clackamas Cougar volleyball players. And to my immediate right is Kristen Nikki Tilton. And we have Jessica Rowley, and welcome to Sportslook.
Hi, Coach. How are you doing?
Good. That was kind of a delayed answer, but I'll accept it, okay? How are you doing, Jessica?
Good, Coach. How are you doing?
Good. Okay. The first thing we're going to talk about is how both of you ended up here. Jessica, I've told this story on the show before, but I was recruiting another player, and on the tape that we had seen, I saw you on the other side of the net, so that's how we got in touch with you. Little did we know that you were a two-sport athlete. And, you know, you've done really well with that. And how do you surmise things for this past year, how things went volleyball-wise and softball-wise?
I'd have to say they went a lot better softball-wise. But I had fun in both sports. Could have done a lot better in volleyball. Probably could do a lot better this year, too.
Did you think the competition was pretty strong on the volleyball side?
Yeah.
Especially when we're in the conference with the number one team in the nation. It's not easy, is it?
Nope.
Now, Nikki, people are going to say, you know, they've already said, are those two sisters, you know, and we've had that comment before. And
twins.
Actually, you're from the same junior college, but you were somewhere else before you were here. Where were you?
Yeah, I was attending Alabama A&M University in Huntsville, Alabama.
And what were you doing there?
I was setting, actually, but my setting days are over. So I've started playing defense here at Eastern.
Okay. And why did you want to come to Eastern in the first place? I know it was me.
Well, besides you, Coach, it was Jessica. I wanted to finish up playing volleyball with her like we did at Clackamas. We've been good friends since, and phone bills were extremely high calling Portales all the time. So.
And it's hard to imagine that anyone could talk to Jessica for that long.
I know.
When she maybe says like 3 or 4 words the entire time you're visiting with her.
I like to talk to her, though.
You like to talk to her, though. Okay. All right. Well, tell us, what are you majoring in, Nikki?
I'm majoring in marketing.
And how's that going?
It's going. It seems like it's taking forever, but it'll be worth it in the end.
So you will graduate?
I will graduate.
Okay. And Jessica, how about you?
I'm majoring in physical education, and I will, too, graduate someday.
Okay. Someday?
Yeah.
2, 3, 4, 5 years?
I'm thinking next year.
Next year.
Next
okay,
December.
That's good. The audience loves to hear things like that. Okay.
Now,
you know, it's Nikki, you've been moved to a defensive specialist position, and Jessica's playing outside. And we got off to kind of a rough start. We were 0-7, but we've kind of rebounded. We've won 15 out of our last 20 matches. Nikki, go ahead and just give us your feelings on how things have gone up to this point.
We're starting to play a lot better now, more as a team. We have our downs, but we're really trying to pick it up. I think we just really need to work on our defense mainly, and then I think our offense will come. But we're gonna do well once we get to the tournament.
Okay. And Jessica, how about you? It's been kind of a rocky road.
Yeah, it was a bad start, but we're doing a lot better now. I think we're playing the team sometimes when we want to, I guess.
Now, you're both from the same junior college. How do you compare the level of play at the two places? Nikki, you first.
I think the girls are a lot bigger now, hit more down, it's harder to dig balls, it's definitely a lot faster, but got to give credit to junior college volleyball, it's tough, mm-hmm. It really is, it's just a step up.
Okay, Jess, what do you think?
I agree with her, it's about the same, it's just a lot faster here.
Okay, now we've got some highlights, okay, and you can throw in comments, we're going to visit these highlights and just feel free to say anything you want, but this is last weekend when we played over at Canyon, Texas, and of course this was in a loss to Incarnate Word, but as a team we rebounded and won the next two matches versus Midwestern and St. Mary's. So go ahead, anything you see out there, let
us
know.
Pass.
Of course, that's your former Cougar teammate there, Jessica Rowley, with a nice slide on the right side.
She just learned how to do that.
It was only because of the pass.
It was only because of the pass, and Nikki just learned how to do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly.
Now, you know, Jessica, you've been over to West Texas when they've had crowds there. What? How do you describe playing in the box?
It's loud and intense. I don't.
Would you call it the perfect volleyball environment?
No.
If that was your school?
If it were our school, yeah. It'd help a lot.
It's very hard to hear.
Yeah. It's easy to get into someone's head.
Okay, now, this was a pretty good team. I mean, they really, you know, they were pretty consistent that night. I don't think we played nearly our best, but they were pretty consistent, and we did have moments where we looked good. And, of course, we're entering the mid-stretch of our season now. We've got, like, 6 matches left, and the conference is kind of up for grabs, you know, where the places are going to fall. What do you feel our chances are of making the conference tournament?
I definitely think we'll make it. Just depends on which spot we're going to take. Depending on how we step up against West Texas and Abilene, mm-hmm. Is going to depend on what place we get.
Okay. Now, you guys we're headed off to Kingsville this weekend. Kingsville first and then Tarleton. And, you know, they're nowhere near each other, and it's a hard trip. And, Jessica, you made that trip last year. Do the fans have any idea, you know, how long a trip that is?
No. I'm just glad we're not driving, I guess.
Yeah. Now, softball is going to go there this year. So, I mean, you get to go to Corpus Christi twice.
I can't wait.
She sounds very enthusiastic about that. Okay. Now, another thing is, you know, people are going to want to know how you guys got involved in the sport anyway. Like, when did you start? Because, you know, we have a lot of followers, and they're not all college students. We have a lot of young kids that follow us. So, Jessica, how did you first get started in volleyball?
My parents made me quit playing soccer to play volleyball. And I was kind of mad then, but I'm really glad now that it happened.
What kind of soccer player were you?
I don't know. It was a long time ago. Well, I thought I was good then.
And the reason I bring that up is because it's a possibility it may be a sport here in the next couple of years. So, Nikki, what about you?
I've always been a basketball player. And then in middle school, it was just kind of something to do to fill the time. You know, you're one of those people who just does every sport whenever you can. And that's how I was. And then in high school is when it started getting serious and playing a lot of club volleyball.
Okay, now a quick shout out to anybody back at Clackamas you might want to say hey to.
To Sue. My best friend Sue.
To Big Dragon,
Big Dragon, our coach. And who is that?
Kathy Woods.
Okay, Kathy Woods.
Yeah.
A couple of Cougars saying hello.
And our wrestling friends, can't forget them.
Okay.
Prime Go Boys.
Hey, you two have been a pleasure to have on. We appreciate it, and good luck this weekend.
All right, thanks, Coach.
Thanks to my crew for finding that segment with Mike McGuire talking a little bit of volleyball with a couple of volleyball players. And let me finish up with a kind of volleyball-related overtime right now. Every time I bring in a student athlete like Jasmine Gannon, I look at the student athlete and I wonder if that student athlete will someday be in the Eastern New Mexico University Hall of Honors. Well, if Jasmine Gannon goes into the Hall of Honors, she'll actually be the second person named Gannon to be in the Hall of Honors because her mother, Sandra Gutierrez Gannon, is already there. So, Jasmine, that'd be a cool mother-daughter act. Well, that is going to wrap up an episode of Sportslook, finishing up my overtime here. I'd like to thank Jasmine for being my guest. I'd like to thank the Sportslook crew for finding that segment with Mike McGuire talking a little volleyball. I'd like to thank my floor director, Ms. Claire. So for all those aforementioned people, this is Doc Elder saying,
one, two,
so long.
One, two, three. Now, baby, you're casting your spell on me.